Discussion with you guys about challenges and open problems. And for this one, you know, there aren't going to be like big math derivations, so we're not going to use the board or the overhead, and there's no video for you guys to watch in advance. We'll just do everything here in class. But you should still feel free to interrupt me and ask questions as we go. So this, you know, this is slightly more structured material than what we usually do, but still feel free to speak up if you have anything that you want to discuss. All right, so I figured that I would start off just to, with a really brief retrospective on kind of a concept map of the things we covered in this class, just to give you some idea of what we've gone through. So the class is broadly speaking about learning-based control. We first talked about imitation learning as a way to do learning-based control, and then we talked about reinforcement learning. And there we covered classic reinforcement learning algorithms, which included policy gradients and value-based methods, as well as actor-critic methods, which kind of combine the two. We talked about specific value-based methods like deep Q learning, specific actor-critic methods that use Q functions, and you guys implemented that in your homework. And we talked about advanced policy gradient methods and some cool concepts there that lead to practical algorithms like TRPO and PPO. Then we also talked about model-based control, which in its most basic form had nothing to do whatsoever with learning, but could be combined with learning to do model-based RL without policies. And then it could further be combined with these classic RL methods to get model-based RL with policies. We talked about exploration. And from exploration, we also talked about unsupervised RL, where you change the problem statement a little bit. And then we talked about probabilistic inference, how that leads to control as inference, and that in turn leads to inverse RL. So that's a more or less complete map of all the things we cover in this class. There's also some transfer learning and meta learning, but that's basically what we've learned about. So today, what I'm going to talk about is, well, what else is missing? What are kind of some big challenges and open problems? And then I'll give you a few kind of perspectives on reinforcement learning that are a little bit outside of what we cover in this class, but might kind of get you to think about reinforcement learning in new ways. And, you know, especially as you're contemplating topics for your, well, hopefully not topics, but implementations for your final project. But let's talk about kind of the basic challenges. And this, a lot of this might be stuff that you guys already expect, but it's kind of good to go over it. So the big challenges with current reinforcement learning algorithms, I can broadly categorize them into two groups. Challenges with core algorithms, meaning like if you nail down, if you go back here, if you nail down this, that you're in this classic model free RL algorithms box in the middle, what are the challenges there? And then challenges with the problem formulation, which is everything around that box. So the challenges with core algorithms are things like stability. Like, do you have an algorithm that converges easily? Is it easy to pick its hyperparameters? Does it tend to work reliably as you change the problem? So this is all hopefully stuff that you guys noticed and might be a little bit of a challenge as you were doing your homeworks. Efficiency, how long does it take to converge? Can you start running homework 3-4 hours before the deadline, or do you really need to start at 12 hours before the deadline, right? So this is the kind of stuff that is particularly important if you have very complex tasks or even real world tasks. And generalization, which is something that we often kind of sweep under the rug when we work on kind of standard reinforcement learning benchmark problems, but that's a much bigger deal in the real world, is that, well, once you do learn something with RL, will it work in a variety of different situations? And then there's also challenges with the basic problem setting, challenges with the assumptions that RL algorithms make. For example, well, these all basically boil down to the question, is it even the right problem formulation? But for example, this could be things like, is it reasonable to assume that the task is defined by a reward function? Is it reasonable to assume that the task is episodic, all this kind of stuff? What kind of supervision do we get, and so on. So let's talk about these things a little bit. So the first big core algorithms challenge I mentioned is stability and hyperparameter tuning. And this is a really big deal. And devising stable RL algorithms is very hard. It's not really something that we worry all that much about when we're doing kind of classic supervised deep learning. We worry about it a little bit, like some architectures are easier to optimize than others. But in reinforcement learning, this is a really, really big problem. And partly it's because the different kinds of reinforcement learning algorithms we have, they all have something a little broken about them when it comes to optimization. Generally, the overall flavor of a reinforcement learning algorithm is that everything is very clean and principled and theoretically sound in simple, small tabular domains. But once we make it, you know, nonlinear, complicated, and use neural nets for everything, some of the guarantees that we had in the simple tabular settings go out the window. So, for example, in the world of Q learning or value-based methods, fitted Q or value-based methods with deep neural networks are typically not contractions, which means that there's no guarantee of convergence. And we talked about that when we introduced value-based methods, and then we talked about how there's all these hacks and tricks that you do if you want your deep Q learning algorithms to work. And partly maybe the reason you need those hacks and those tricks is because the underlying algorithms are not quite right. So that's the picture from the theory section. Policy gradient methods. Well, in some ways, policy gradient methods are maybe a little bit better in the sense that you can actually construct reasonable convergence guarantees, but that comes at the cost of using very high variance estimators. And in practice, if you want your policy gradient methods to work well, you would typically still introduce some kind of value function, either as a baseline or as a critic, which would import all the issues from the bullet point above. But if you wanted to deal with the high variance, then you need to be careful with your parameter choices, learning rates, batch sizes, et cetera. And then model-based RL algorithms, well, there's a bunch of choices you have to make, like the model class and the fitting method. But perhaps the bigger challenge there is that, in general, for kind of classic model-based RL methods, there isn't really any guarantee that a more accurate model will lead to better performance. That might seem a little bit counterintuitive, but the rationale is something like, well, the model can be made more accurate in the sense that it can predict things more accurately in all sorts of ways, but if it misses that one really critical thing that you need to get a good policy, the policy can be arbitrarily bad. So essentially, not all model errors are made equal, and simply reducing model error doesn't necessarily improve resulting policy performance. So there's essentially an objective mismatch. And there are also more subtle issues, like, for example, the model exploitation that we talked about before and how we discussed how uncertainty estimation can mitigate it, but you know, it's still a problem. So long story short, there is some kind of issue like this with pretty much any reinforcement learning method. It's a different issue, seemingly, for different methods. You know, there's probably an underlying reason why that is, but that means that there's a lot of work left to do. So, you know, one of the things to consider if you're interested in addressing that kind of issue is, well, is there a way to devise methods that perhaps don't suffer from either those conceptual problems, or is there a way to better understand those conceptual problems so that we can have more principled ways of mitigating them rather than, you know, doing things like using gradient clipping in the right way? Any questions about this? Sample complexity. So for sample complexity, let me show you a graphic that I actually made this a few years back, so it might be a little bit out of date at this point, but I think it gives you kind of the general gist of the idea. So we can imagine drawing a kind of a hierarchy of reinforcement learning algorithms where we're going to put the ones that require the most samples to learn at the top and the ones that require the least samples at the bottom. And there are, you know, obviously a few ways that I could select what goes in that hierarchy, but here's one way that we could look at it. At the top, we'd have some gradient-free methods. We didn't actually cover these in this course, but you can essentially use derivative-free optimization. This is things like natural evolution strategies, CMA, et cetera, for optimizing policy. So these are essentially evolutionary algorithms. We don't cover them in this course because it's pretty tough to get them to work in some cases, but these are probably the most sample-hungry methods. Then we have fully online methods, fully on-policy methods. So these are policy gradient methods or online actor-critic methods like A3C. Efficient policy gradient methods use some kind of natural gradient or some trick to basically mitigate the high variance. Those would be a little bit below that. Then we would have off-policy methods. So these are methods that use some kind of replay buffer. So this would be deep Q learning, DDPG, SAC, et cetera. This is basically homework three. Then we might have some model-based deep RL methods, like homework four, basically. And then we might have some non-deep model-based RL methods, like, for example, you can do model-based RL with Gaussian processes or other kinds of shallow function approximators. So I have some examples of, like, you know, papers that implemented these. And what I did is I went through these papers and I tried to find similar tasks to try to gauge the difference in sample efficiency. Now, the trouble is that not every paper has exactly the same task. So basically, what I'm going to do here is for every pair of things in that hierarchy, I'll try to find a paper from each adjacent pair of categories to see what the difference in sample complexity is. So for the evolutionary methods versus the fully online methods, it seems like it's about a 10x difference. So this is a cheetah task from a paper from 2017 that uses A3C, and it requires on the order of 100 million steps of the cheetah. It's actually a slightly different cheetah than the one you have in the homework, but you know, close enough. So this would be the equivalent of, if this was a real cheetah running around, it would be running around for 15 days. This is a plot for a 2016 TRPO plus GAE method. So here the half cheetah is running around for 1.5 days, so about 10x less. For the evolutionary ones, it would be, I guess, about half a year, 150 days. Hunting down some cheetah-based thing for a replay buffer method. This is Gu et al. 2016, about 1 million steps, 3 hours of real time. And conveniently enough, there's another paper by Gu et al., a different one actually, but by the same person, that shows that he can learn a real-world robotics task in about 3 hours. So it kind of seems like order of magnitude, that's about the right number, not just for half cheetah. So we're talking about hours of training time. For the model-based RL stuff, this is from the PETS paper. So here it's about 5 minutes of real time. So again, about a 10x step down. And for kind of shallow methods, then this is stuff like PILCO, which we didn't cover in this course, but it's basically model-based RL with a Gaussian process. There you can actually learn very simple tasks in seconds. The problem is that the Gaussian processes don't really scale up to larger problems. So they can be kind of compared on the same benchmarks. So long story short, there are really big differences in sample efficiency depending on what kind of method we use. But at this point, you might say, well, why don't we just use the things at the bottom? Like, those seem to be the most efficient, those are the best ones. Any ideas to why somebody might want to use the things up at the top? Yeah, back there. Yeah, so scalability is one concern. So certainly, the complexity of a problem that you can solve with each of these methods is going to be a little different. Like, for example, if you want to use a model-based RL method for an image-based task, that is possible, but then you would need a much more complex model. Another reason actually has to do with computational efficiency. So just because something is sample efficient doesn't mean it's computationally efficient. Running a state-of-the-art model-based RL method might actually require more compute time than running a state-of-the-art policy gradient method if that policy gradient method can use a very fast simulator. So sample efficiency is not actually necessarily the best thing if it comes at the cost of computational efficiency. And that's because those model-based RL methods would be training the models for many, many gradient steps for each simulation step. So of course, if interacting with your system is extremely costly, like maybe each time step is like an hour of interaction with a real world HVAC system or something, like, yeah, then you probably want to be really sample efficient. But if you're doing stuff like playing chess, where simulating one move in chess is just a few milliseconds on a computer, then maybe you don't care as much about sample efficiency, and you'd rather have a method that is computationally efficient, or even one that is maximally parallelizable, which is the big appeal of the ones at the very top, those evolutionary algorithms. They're not even computationally efficient, but they're actually very fast if you have a data center where you can run like a million threads in parallel, right? So that's a trade-off that people make in practice, and you'll actually often see that for RL problems that are solved primarily in simulation, people might prefer something like a policy gradient method or an online actor critic method, as opposed to the more efficient stuff at the bottom. Any questions here? Yeah, back there. So what do you mean by identify the model? So in model-based RL, we learn the model from interaction with the system. Do you mean like the model class or? Right. Well, okay, so if you're in this class and you want to use deep reinforcement learning, presumably, then the model is a deep network. Now, what kind of deep network works best for your particular system depends on the system. So there are a few high-level decision points. Like, for example, if you have an image-based system, then you probably want a pretty different kind of model than if you have a low-dimensional continuous system. If you have a discrete system, then you might also need a slightly different model. They're not that different, because in the end, it's just a neural net with particular inputs and outputs. But yeah, there's probably a lot more design decisions that go into a predictive model that can handle images, for example. And that's not like a fundamental issue. It's just something where there's a lot more research that goes into it. You could, yes. So if you want to do that, you could absolutely do that. You don't have to. But yes, if you have prior knowledge about your domain, you could incorporate that into the design of your model. Yeah, you could definitely do that, and that would be more situational, and would probably make it better if you get it right, and make it worse if you get it wrong. Yeah, that's a good question. So, at least looking at the literature on like that paper and follow-ups, mostly the benefits seem to have to do with parallelizability. So, if the cost of simulation is trivial, and you can parallelize as much as you want, like you have a data center at your disposal, it is in some cases actually better to use massive parallelism, even if it comes at an enormous increase in the total amount computational cost, and that's what those methods will give you. The word evolutionary is very misleading there. Like, these methods have absolutely nothing to do with evolution. They're basically derivative-free optimization algorithms. So if you want like a rough mental model for what they do, think like finite differences. So basically perturb the parameters this way and that and see which way the perturbation improves performance. Not on any benchmarks. There are settings where they do perform better. Anecdotally, I can tell you about them. Generally, the settings where they perform better are settings where, for whatever reason, parameter space exploration is preferable to state space exploration. That's not the case on, as far as I know, any of the widely used benchmarks, but there are definitely tasks you can construct that are like that. Typically, these are tasks that have a sparse reward where exploration is difficult. But like not in the same sense as in Montezuma's Revenge, where you have to do like a sequence of stuff, but where you have to find the right behavior in a space of behaviors. So there are tasks like that. As far as I know, there are no standard benchmarks like that. Although there are a lot of benchmarks, so I might be missing something. Yeah, back there. Well, I wouldn't say that it's certainly not incorrect in any way, and I wouldn't even say that it's not more common. I mean, like, you know, I would say that for the majority of robotic systems that are actually deployed in an industrial setting, they're going to be using model-based control where somebody characterized the dynamics of the system, probably, you know, has a good CAD model that they can use to compute a mass matrix, which they then use for impedance control, right? Like that would be a classical way to do robotic control in any kind of practical setting today. In terms of the trade-off between that and learning a model, it really comes down to something very similar to a classic bias variance trade-off in machine learning, where adding prior knowledge reduces the amount of data you need, but the prior knowledge is rarely perfectly correct. It's rarely a perfect characterization of the system. So what happens is that once you do have enough data, then the slightly incorrect prior knowledge actually results in getting the wrong answer. And that's not something profoundly specific to control. It's actually just a general bias variance trade-off in machine learning. Yes? We'll get to that in about 30 minutes. All right, let's move on. So, why does sample complexity matter? I think most of you have probably already guessed this from the discussion, but it's everything from needing to wait for a long time for homework three to finish, all the way to basically real-world learning becoming completely impractical, because if your method requires 150 days to run and it needs to run in the real world, you can't run an experiment that long. So these are important things, and they affect the kind of problems that we can solve. So one very important direction for research in reinforcement learning is developing algorithms with better sample complexity, developing methods that can have better sample complexity without requiring a lot more compute, and developing methods that can have better sample complexity without introducing too many additional hyperparameters that lead to more instability. So that's a big thing. And the last kind of core algorithms thing I wanted to touch on, which sort of transitions into problem statement issues, is generalization. And we don't really worry about this too much for the kind of tasks that we study in this course. It's not like, for example, on homework three, you don't have to train on like five different Atari games and have your policy then generalize to a sixth one. You just want to see if you can learn the one game that you're training on. But in reality, if you want to use reinforcement learning to learn something that will actually act in the real world, it probably needs to deal with real-world variability. And that might be a little bit of variability, or it might be a lot of variability. So outside of RL, generalization is usually the most important thing. If you're doing like image recognition on ImageNet, it's a large-scale task, it emphasizes diversity, and it's evaluated on generalization. If you're getting this thing to walk, it's a small-scale task, it emphasizes mastery, like basically how high can you make the reward value be, and it's evaluated on final performance. Like basically the faster it walks, the better. No one's gonna be checking whether like it can walk on a different terrain or something like that. But they could, and that could be maybe a better way to evaluate reinforcement learning methods. So there's a bit of a problem here. Like let me explain it with an example. So in supervised machine learning, the way that we would get generalization is we would collect a large data set, maybe ImageNet, and that data set that is collected once, the data set is then stored to disk, and then we would load up that data set, train some neural network model on it, evaluate its performance, and if we're not happy with it, we would train a different neural net on the same data set. But we don't go and like recollect all of ImageNet if you're not happy with how well your image classifier is doing. You might add more images to it, that's a perfectly valid thing to do, but you probably not throw out all the stuff you already got. Whereas reinforcement learning kind of classically is this iterative process where you collect a little bit of data, you update on that data, you throw the data in the garbage, and you update some more. And even if you're doing off-policy reinforcement learning, you would still probably collect new data each experiment. And in reality, it's actually even worse than that, because in actual reinforcement learning, there's also this outer loop, which is basically you guys. So if you run a little experiment and you needed to collect new data to run the experiment, and you're not happy with how the experiment went, then you would tweak something and then you'd run the whole thing again. And that's fine if we're doing it at kind of a smaller scale where we just want the little simulated robot to run really fast. But if you were to do this at a larger scale where you need kind of real-world level of generalization, and the amount of data you need is kind of at the same level as what you would need for generalization and supervised learning, like ImageNet, for example, well, then you're kind of looking at the prospect of collecting an ImageNet-sized data set each time you run an experiment. And that becomes completely impractical. With real data, you could use simulated data. That would be expensive, but viable. With real-world data, it's basically impossible. This is a little anecdote of just how bad that is. This is the example from TRPO GAE. This is a little walking robot that learns to walk. It's pretty cool. And if this was a real robot, it would take 6 days of real time. Now, of course, there's more efficient algorithms since then. This is an older paper, but point is that it takes a while. But the problem is not that just that it takes a while, it's that it's doing this to learn to run on an infinitely wide, flat plane with nothing on it. In reality, if you want an actual robot that learns to run, well, then it needs to run on all sorts of different surfaces and all sorts of different settings, and all of those combinatorial degrees of freedom would explode the number of situations that you need to train in massively. So it wouldn't actually be 6 days or 6 hours or whatever it is. It would be that times some very large additional coefficient to account for the amount of variability that you'd need to have to generalize effectively. Potentially off-policy or offline RL can be a way to deal with this. Maybe there could be some way to collect that data, save it to disk, and then reuse it the same way that we do in supervised learning. Perhaps more efficient methods or the appropriate use of transfer learning could be a way to deal with that. But this is a big challenge when it comes to actually using RL methods in a realistic setting. Okay. And of course, the question of generalization is very deeply tied to multitask learning. If you want to generalize across, for example, the different environments for running, then in effect, you're solving multiple tasks to get that kind of generalization. And we talked about how it's not actually that difficult to take a multitask learning problem and turn it into, at least the formalism, turn it into a standard MDP. You can just have this MDP where on the first time step, you randomly pick a different initial state, and each initial state is a different task, and that's totally reasonable. That's a way that you can embed a multitask learning problem into a standard MDP that any RL algorithm can solve. But that doesn't mean that it makes it easy to solve. So maybe you don't read any, maybe you don't need any new assumption, but it might merit some additional treatment, some additional machinery that makes these kind of problems easier to solve or more efficient, because they do come up all the time if you want generalization. And then the last kind of challenge that sort of steps outside of the reinforcement learning problem that I wanted to talk about is where the supervision comes from. So if you want to learn many different tasks, for example, for that multitasking, if you want generalization, those tasks need to come from somewhere. And if you are playing an Atari game like in Homework 3, it's pretty natural to say, well, the task is defined by a reward, and the reward is a score because it's a game, and the game has a score. So it's kind of obvious what your reward should be, and it all checks out. But in a real-world task, it's not so simple. And sometimes just evaluating whether you're doing it successfully can be just as hard, if not harder, than actually doing the task. So, you know, in the picture on the right, if you want to pour a glass of water, well, any kid can tell that you've poured a glass of water correctly. But for your learning algorithm, for your robot, for example, to figure that out, well, you might need an entire perception system just to detect water in a cup, just so that you know that you've done it correctly. And this kind of stuff becomes even more complicated if you imagine tasks that that somehow implicate human preferences, driving a car in a way that makes the passenger happy, that sort of thing. And this becomes a really big challenge. So there's all sorts of things we could study to mitigate that challenge, including some of the things we covered in this course, like learning objectives and rewards from demonstration, maybe even generating objectives automatically, like in the unsupervised RL discussion that we had. So this is really a big kind of question, and a lot of different avenues could be explored to address it. Using demonstrations, using language, using human preferences. You can imagine an RL agent that does something and asks the person, is this better or worse than what I did before? So there's a lot to do here. But more broadly, what I would say is that, like, you know, if you're thinking about important open problems in RL, don't be afraid to think about the problem definition itself. How should we really be defining a control problem? Reinforcement learning, the classic reinforcement learning paradigm, gives us one way to do that. But it's not the only way. You can ask, well, what is the data that we're going to use? Is it going to be the data that the agent collects itself, or is it going to be prior data that obtained, or some combination of those things? What is the goal? Is the goal specified by a reward function, specified by a description, by user preferences, by human demonstration? There's many ways to get that, and what kind of supervision does it get? Maybe the supervision might not be the same as the goal. Perhaps there's the goal of the task, and there's some side information that helps the agent figure out how to do the task. The reward function actually entangles these two things, but that's not the only way to do it. And you can also think about the assumptions that fit your problem setting, because the classic reinforcement learning problem statement is not necessarily the right one for any particular application area. So don't assume that the basic RL problem is set in stone. Okay, so on that note, there are kind of three perspectives on reinforcement learning that are a little different from the kind of the mainstream thing that we covered in this course that I want to tell you about for the rest of today's lecture. First one is going to be reinforcement learning seen as a kind of engineering tool. The second one is reinforcement learning as a way to learn in the real world. And the third one will be reinforcement learning as a way to have a kind of a universal training or even pre-training procedure. I'll see if I can get through all of those, but maybe I'll get through at least the first couple. So let's start with the first one. When we saw the reinforcement learning problem statement, thinking all the way back to lecture one, classically, this is always introduced as a very kind of naturalistic learning style. Like, you know, reinforcement learning, its history is rooted in psychology and in work by folks like B.F. Skinner, who essentially were interested in reinforcement learning as a model of how animals learn. So it's very tempting to introduce the reinforcement learning problem by saying, well, it's like when you have a dog and you give the dog a treat or you give it punishment and you try to get the dog to do what you want. And that's very evocative. That gets us thinking about, oh, like reinforcement learning is like a nice way to think about intelligent agents. But it's not the only way that we can contextualize this. Here's a very different way to think about reinforcement learning. Let's say that you had a job which was to build a control system for one of these, like, you know, very established classical organizations. Like maybe you work for NASA. Like, you know, you got to make the rocket fly. If you say the word, if you say the phrase reinforcement learning at NASA, you know, people start looking at you weird. So you're not going to say that. you're going to say, well, we're going to write down equations of motion, and we're going to design a controller, and it's going to be very rigorous and very provable, and it's going to fly the rocket straight every single time. It's going to be great. So what do you do? You write down partial differential equations, hopefully the right ones. Never perfectly the right ones, but hopefully close enough. And then there's a bunch of math that you do that you would learn in class on linear systems, for example, in the electrical engineering department, which would tell you how to turn this giant system of equations into some kind of feedback controller that would fly that rocket so that it, you know, it does what it's supposed to be doing. And we tend to think of this as like completely different from anything in reinforcement learning. But what are we really doing here? We're designing a kind of a simulator of our system. That's the equations of motion. And then we're using that simulator to figure out how to control the system to accomplish some task. And optimal control is, you know, at the end of the day, minimizing some cost functional, whether explicitly or implicitly. So maybe it's not that different. And in fact, you know, for flying the rocket, maybe the differential equations are easy enough to write down that they fit on a page. I don't actually know if those equations describe a rocket. They're just something I found on the internet. But you could probably write the equations that describe a rocket on one page. But for other physical systems, that's not the case. So you could build very sophisticated simulators, you know, finite element analysis, that sort of thing, that would fairly accurately, fairly faithfully model very complex physical interactions. But it's very hard to write down just a concise set of equations that describes that. And that's where a lot of the traditional controls methods start hitting a wall. Well, you can think of reinforcement learning as just a way to invert some kind of simulation. Basically, with reinforcement learning, if you can simulate it, then you can control it. And now reinforcement learning starts looking a lot more like a traditional engineering tool. Whereas before, we would write down those systems of equations and do a bunch of math to get the controller. Now we're going to write down those systems of equations, which might be much more complicated, and run some kind of reinforcement learning algorithm through that simulator to back out a controller. So replace the world with the matrix, basically, and you get a very powerful engineering tool. Anything you can simulate, you can control. It's not that different from a conventional engineering approach, because the conventional approach still involves characterizing the system, which is essentially a simulator, and then backing out a controller. It's just that this one is a bit more automated. So before, characterize, simulate, control. Now characterize, simulate, run RL. And the main role is really it's a powerful inversion engine, something that inverts your simulator to give you a control strategy. And this way of thinking about reinforcement learning is very pragmatic if what you're concerned with is solving engineering problems. Engineering control problems in an engineering setting. Because current pipelines for solving those problems already involve building a simulator of a system, even if we don't conventionally think of an equations of motion as a simulator. So that's one perspective you could take on reinforcement learning. The main weakness is that you still need to simulate, but hey, that could still be a really powerful tool. All right, any questions about this part? Or comments or disagreements? Yeah. Yeah. Well, at the end of the day, reinforcement learning is just an optimization procedure. So if you want to have, let's say, trajectory tracking in a known, well-characterized system, you can do it perfectly with reinforcement learning. You might need to train for a really long time, and maybe the optimal setting for the algorithm that does that might not be exactly the same as the optimal settings for like the stuff that you guys were doing in homework 2 or homework 3, but it's definitely possible. My point here is just that it's actually not that different. Like in the same way that you might solve a quadratic program for MPC, well, that's an optimization procedure. You can run a policy gradient, that's a different optimization procedure. Yes.
Yeah.
There's actually a fair bit of work on that. Maybe the simplest way I can answer that question is the following. So the classic way to guarantee stability certainly for a linear system, but also for a nonlinear system, would be to show the existence of a Lyapunov function that is valid in the region where your system is going to be situated. A value function is essentially a Lyapunov function. And you can make that there's a weak version of that statement, a value function looks like a Lyapunov function, but there's actually a strong version of it is literally a Lyapunov function if you choose the reward function properly. So based on that, there's actually a whole bunch of work that basically tries to intersect concepts from stability with reinforcement learning. And if you search for reinforcement learning Lyapunov function on Google, you probably find dozens of papers about that. I don't want to make it sound like that's completely solved, because there's a lot of big open questions that start to arise, especially when you bring in function approximation. Like, usually function approximation is what makes everything go wrong. But it's an active area of research. Yeah? Yes. Thank you. I should amend that then. Anything you can simulate and reward. But typically, if we're talking about a setting where we know how the system works, meaning that we can write down equations of motion or we can build a simulator, at that point we have all the variables at our fingertips. So, for the rocket example, the objective probably wouldn't be, avoid this like really bad thing due to aerodynamics. You would simulate aerodynamics however you see fit, and the objective would be like fly the rocket along the desired trajectory. So it's not always trivial. But in many of these kinds of engineering settings, the objective function is not really the big problem. Yeah. Well, I think you can approach it in different ways. Like, I think classically you would learn a policy, and the policy would be the thing that you would retain. But you could imagine something like a meta-learning method, which would actually learn an adaptation procedure. It's a little bit more exotic and unconventional, but it's possible. But yeah, I think you're right that classically you would get a policy, and that would be the artifact that you would take away from this whole procedure. Okay, Moving on, the next perspective, which is a very different perspective, in fact, maybe a diametrically opposite perspective that I want to describe, is how we can think of reinforcement learning as a way to handle the unpredictability of the real world. Okay. And I want to start this discussion with a little kind of anecdote. So in 1996, Garry Kasparov was defeated by a computer, and this was the first time that a world champion at chess was defeated by a computer. This was in 1996. And this is a photograph of that match, and you can see Garry Kasparov there on the left, and on the right, there is another person. Now, he was defeated by a computer, but there's still a person there moving the pieces. And fast forward 20 years, Lisa Dahl was defeated by a computer. This was the world champion at Go, another major milestone. But again, there's a person moving the pieces. And this illustrates a particular challenge that we have with AI systems situated in the real world. So even though the game, the chess game or the Go game, takes place in the real world, the computer is only controlling the system at the level of abstraction of the actual pieces, and there's still a person moving the pieces around. And this is a very vivid illustration of something that AI researchers, particularly in robotics, have known for a very long time. This is often known as Moravec's paradox. So the original statement by Hans Moravec, written there, is we're all produced Olympians in perceptual and motor areas, so good that we make the difficult look easy. Abstract thought, though, is a new trick, perhaps less than 100,000 years old. So abstract thought, that's what Garry Kasparov was doing. We have not yet mastered it. It is not all that intrinsically difficult, which is a little bit of an insult to Garry Kasparov, perhaps. It just seems so when we do it. So this is basically saying, like, we're kind of bad at abstract thought, but we're really good at moving our hands. And this is a more modernized version of that statement by Steven Pinker. The main lesson of 35 years of AI research is that the hard problems are easy and the easy problems are hard. The mental abilities of a four-year-old that we take for granted, recognizing a face, lifting a pencil, walking across a room, answering a question, in fact, solve some of the hardest engineering problems ever conceived. So this is maybe like a little bit of food for thought for the kinds of problems that are challenging for AI versus the kinds of problems that maybe we don't really need AI for. So Marvick's paradox seems like a statement about AI, but you could also actually interpret it as a statement about our physical universe. So like the universe represented by the rules of the game of chess maybe doesn't suffer from this, but ours does. So there's maybe some easy universe and hard universes. Not easy and hard in the sense of like they're computationally difficult, but easy and hard in the sense that you need really sophisticated AI methods to solve problems in one, but not the other. So the easy universes appear to be, for some strange reason, the game of chess and the game of Go, and also like launching a rocket. Because, well, it's actually not that difficult to build a control algorithm for launching a rocket. Kind of weird to say that's easy, but the hard universes are like, you know, this stuff. Interacting with other agents, playing with children, picking up the chess pieces, right? So it seems like some of these problems are a lot harder than others, and yet they don't seem hard to us, just because we have to be good at them just to survive in the world that we inhabit. So that's basically Marvick's paradox. Okay, the example that I gave actually in this was actually in the first lecture is also an instance of this problem. If you have an oil tanker and you want to navigate the oil tanker halfway around the world, it's not that difficult to write some code. You can use A-star search if you like to actually navigate the tanker, but you probably still want a person on board in case something breaks in the engine room and someone has to go down there with a wrench and fix it, because your A-star search is not going to tell you how to move the wrench. So what does it have to do with RL? Well, maybe one of the ways that we can think about RL, one perspective we can take on it, is it's a way to engineer a system to deal with the unexpected. And that's really the big challenge. The chess pieces, well, the problem is that they're all different shapes and it might be a little slippery and maybe your hand is sweaty because you're playing against Garry Kasparov, perfectly understandable. So things just aren't quite the way you expect. And the thing that broke in the engine room isn't the same as the thing that broke the last five times. So it's the unexpected that really gives us so much trouble. There's a nice story that you know, people often find compelling, Robinson Crusoe. It's a man who's stranded on an island and has to fend for himself. And part of what we find kind of compelling about that story, well, besides its dramatic undertones and commentary on colonialism, is that the person uses their ingenuity and flexibility and resourcefulness to come up with effective solutions to unexpected problems. So Robinson Crusoe didn't like practice for decades for the stranded on island championships, practicing all sorts of things like building shelter. No, he had to use his ingenuity to deal with the world as it presented itself in unexpected ways. So in these unexpected situations, you have minimal external supervision about what you should do, and unexpected situations will arise that require you to adapt, that require you to somehow modify your behavior to deal with them. And you have to discover those solutions autonomously. So no one's going to come along and say like, okay, you tried to build shelter, but you messed up. Let me reset the island back the way it was so you can try again. Like, it doesn't work that way. And you have to stay long enough to stay alive long enough to discover these things. So humans are extremely good at this because we have to be. But current AI systems are actually very bad at this. And in principle, RL can actually do this, and I would actually argue that kind of nothing else can in terms of the current formalisms that we have. Like, you know, supervised learning won't be able to do this kind of stuff because supervised learning requires supervision. That's not to say that, this is not actually a very profound statement, just because RL is a very basic way to formulate the AI problem, but, you know, that's kind of how it is. And you can disagree with me on that if you like. So if RL can do this, what's the problem? Well, the problem is that we rarely actually study this kind of thing. Like, you know, trading policies for the half cheetah to run or to play an Atari game isn't quite the same thing as surviving on a desert island. And there are here are just a few of the differences. So in the easy universes, maybe success means you got a high reward. Like it's not that you managed to like keep the ball in the air for breakout, it's that you got a really high score on breakout. That's what you would call successful. If you just managed to keep the ball in the air, you wouldn't pass homework three. It's a closed world with known rules. Maybe you're running a model-free RL algorithm, but it's still a world where you know the rules, maybe because you know the rules of chess or you have access to the emulator for the Atari game. Typically handled with lots of simulation, like in the previous section. And the main question is really, can your RL algorithm optimize really well? Can it get a really high score? Or, you know, can it make the cheetah run really fast? In the real world, success is more like survival. Like, is it good enough? Like, Robinson Crusoe wasn't concerned with building the most beautiful shelter or catching the most juicy animal. No, he was just concerned with, like, getting by. It's open world, and everything has to come from your experience, from data. There's no simulation because the rules are unknown. It's not necessarily that it's hard to simulate a particular phenomenon you're going to encounter. It's that you don't know what you will encounter, so you can't think ahead in advance to simulate it. And the main question is, can RL generalize and adapt? That's not to say that you have to do everything from scratch, and maybe they do have prior knowledge from your past experience, just like Robinson Crusoe did, but you'll still have to deal with the unknown as you encounter it. So RL should be really good in the hard universes. And maybe that, in the long run, would be the big accomplishment of RL research in the context of AI, is to finally deal with this issue, this Moravec's paradox that has plagued us for so long. Okay, so just to bring this down to something a little more concrete, what are some of the questions that come up in the real world that we don't typically deal with outside of the real world? Well, some of them I've already mentioned, like how do we tell RL agents what we want them to do rather than using the highest score in the game? Can we learn fully autonomously in continual environments? So that thing where, you know, no one's going to reset the island so you can try building the shelter again. He has to deal with the world continuously as it evolves over time. How do you remain robust as the environment changes around you? What's the right way to generalize using experience and prior data? So Robinson Crusoe had prior knowledge before getting to that island, but it was not exactly the knowledge that he needed. So he had to use his knowledge not just to solve the task in zero shot, but to help him figure out how to explore and try different useful things while avoiding the clearly dangerous things. Like, you know, he didn't try jumping off a cliff to see if that might lead to a tastier dinner. No, that's clearly a bad idea. And what's the right way to bootstrap exploration from prior experience? And this is, by the way, all this stuff, it kind of sounds like it's about robots. It's really not about robots. Robots are the most natural for us to think about in this setting because they are embodied just like we are. So if we're going to use analogies to people, then we start thinking about robots. But a lot of the same things happen anytime you try to situate RL agents in the real world, because the real world is continual. You can't reset it magically and so on. So if you're writing, if you're a medical assistance robot and you're writing prescriptions, if you're a chatbot, if you're regulating inventory levels for an e-commerce site, you know, these are all things that are physically situated in the same way. So just a few examples of these things, of the kind of work that people have done to address some of these questions. Many of them are open questions, but there's still some work in that area. Other ways to communicate objectives. One kind of cute example that I wanted to bring up is this paper by Paul Cristiano called Deep Reinforcement Learning from Human Preferences, which proposes a very different way to think about objectives. So here, basically the goal in this paper is to learn tasks for which it's very hard to write down a reward function. And what they do is they use human feedback to figure out what the agent should be doing. So it's essentially, this is sometimes called the optometrist algorithm. So you get two clips, left and right, and you pick which one you prefer. And you use this to guide the agent to discover the skill that you want to perform. And here, the user is guiding the agent to discover the skill of doing a backflip. So it's very hard to write down an equation for the reward function for doing a backflip with a hopper, but after the optometrist algorithm runs, they can get it to do the backflip. So not necessarily saying this is the best way to specify rewards, but this, it's an alternative to the way that we typically think about it in this course. Learning fully autonomously. Here's an anecdote from some work by my former student, Anusha Nagabandi. She developed algorithms for dexterous manipulation where a simulated robotic hand could do all sorts of cool things like writing with a pencil and playing with the bounding balls here. And then she wanted to do it in the real world. And the problem is that in the real world, the robot drops the object all the time. So being a good engineer, of course, she took a second robotic arm and had it put the objects back, which is very pragmatic. But of course, in the real world, you don't necessarily have a helpful robot that just sits there whose sole purpose is to assist you in your learning process. So here's another way you can think about it. I'll use a little coffee machine example. Let's say you have a robot whose job is to figure out how to use a coffee machine. And maybe the robot will try to put the cup in the coffee machine. That's task one. But then it will mess up. Maybe it'll drop the cup. Well, a person could come in and fix it, but if there is no person, maybe this is an opportunity to try task two, which is to pick up the cup. And if it succeeds at that, if it fails at task one and does task two, if it succeeds at task one, then it can try to replace the cup. And if it fails at that, maybe it spills the coffee, so that's an opportunity to clean up the coffee spill. So maybe if you're learning many different tasks at the same time, perhaps the fact that the world is continual like this actually becomes a feature, something that you actually like, rather than an obstacle to be overcome. Each situation you encounter presents you with an opportunity to learn a new skill. We've actually explored this a little bit in my lab for robotic manipulation. This is a robotic hand that's learning skills for repositioning an object, picking it up, flipping it over, and also putting it back down. And that actually allows this robot to train continuously for 60 hours in this case. So that here the student running the experiment went home, probably taking a nap. Well, they must be taking a nap because it takes 60 hours, doing some homework, And then when they come back, the robot has figured out some elaborate skill where it can pick up the object and reposition it in the hand. Bootstrapping from prior experience. This kind of goes under the umbrella of transfer learning that we talked about before, but there's kind of an interesting question here. If you do want to adapt to new situations that you haven't encountered before, that doesn't mean that you have to adapt from scratch. So if you imagine a robotic arm learning how to pick up objects, if it's learning from scratch, maybe initially it's just going to move around randomly. Moving around randomly is what your half cheetah was doing on homework 2, for example. Well, if you have prior experience, what you can do is, it might not tell you how to solve your new task, but it might give you a strong inkling of what kinds of behaviors could be potentially useful. So you take your prior experience and you use it to learn not a policy that solves whatever task you're going to encounter, but a policy that does things that might potentially solve tasks. So maybe it's a very randomized policy. Maybe in this particular world, that policy would just reach for different objects because you know that whatever manipulation task you have, reaching for objects is probably a good idea. So maybe then that initial policy would do stuff like this. So it's not necessarily doing any particular task, it's just kind of trying out, picking up things, maybe putting things on that block, maybe not, random things like that, but things that might be potentially useful. And that can be a lot faster. So maybe there's a lot of research to be done in leveraging prior knowledge, not necessarily to immediately generalize to new tasks, but just to give you a good head start to practice the kind of things that might be potentially useful. Okay, I'll skip over the results. All right, so this all seems really hard. What's the point of all this? Why is this interesting? Well, to me at least, it's actually really exciting to see what solutions intelligent agents come up with. And it's most exciting when they come up with something that we don't expect. And that happens pretty rarely in very simple environments. So this requires that the world that they inhabit actually admit novel solutions. And this means that the world must be complicated enough. And the real world is really complicated. So to see interesting emergent behavior, maybe we have to train our RL agents in environments that actually require interesting emergent behavior to emerge. And that's the real world. So RL in the real world might be difficult, but it might also be really rewarding. So I'll pause there and maybe ask you guys if you have any comments, objections, or questions. Yeah, back there. Yeah. Yeah, it is very difficult to do reinforcement learning if you don't know what you're trying to accomplish, right? So I think that's kind of the problem with a lot of this kind of more open-ended stuff. But I think that there the problem, if I'm understanding your question correctly, I think the challenge has less to do with the reinforcement learning part and more to do with specifying the goal. Which, as I mentioned, that's a really big and important open question. But that's part of why I don't have a great answer for it, because it is an open question. Yeah, over there. It's a good question. There are a few things going on. So you specifically said warehouse, so I think that you're kind of indexing on standard robotics methods. And one thing I would say there is that in a lot of cases, actual deployment of robotic systems in industry is a kind of a coevolution of the task and the autonomous system. So like essentially the factory or the warehouse is built in a way that a robot will work well in it. Whereas if you have a robot like in your home, well, your home is built so that you can use the home, not so that your robot can. So if you're not willing to kind of compromise on the environment, if you want autonomous systems that will work well in the kind of environments that humans inhabit, then they have to have capabilities that are more like those of humans. And that's probably where most of the problems come from. And then from there, everything kind of falls from that. Like you have more variability, you have the kind of affordances that suit humans, and all of that Moravec's paradox kind of behavior, and doesn't necessarily suit robots with their much more rigid model-based skills. So basically, we're very good at certain things, so we'll design environments where the things that we're good at are sufficient, but the robots are not good at those things, so they struggle in those environments. Yes? Yeah, it's a good question. Well, one thing you can do is you can always just store everything you've experienced before and play it back. And that is the dominant solution to that problem. Like the whole replay buffer thing, like, you know, it's not pretty, but it works. people have come up with all sorts of other techniques to try to deal with it. So there's a lot of research on, it's referred to as continual learning typically. And, you know, it has various flavors, like, well, maybe I'll save out checkpoints, and I'll somehow tell my network not to deviate too much from those checkpoints. But without storing all the data, it's actually a big open problem right now. Yeah, let's see how I can. This is a slightly abstract question, but I think the classic reinforcement learning problem formulation says that the only information you get about what the task is the reward signal. And I think maybe one discrepancy here is that that's not really how it works for people typically. Like if I want to get you to do something for me, like maybe I really want you to hand in your homework. I'm not going to just like give you a reward of +1 when you hand in your homework and 0 otherwise. I'm going to tell you like, hey, hand in your homework. And you kind of know what that means because you can speak English and so on, and you know what homework is, and you know what handing it in means. So I think that maybe like part of the issue there is that understanding tasks for humans implicates a lot of the deeper machinery of how we understand the world in general, like the model, so to speak. Whereas in RL, that's not the case in the classic way of doing it. So maybe there needs to be a better way of doing it than the classic way of doing it. Yeah. So there is a lot of work that involves combining language and reinforcement learning. A lot of it goes under the umbrella of instruction following. So it's fairly straightforward to formulate a reinforcement learning problem where part of your observation about the world is an instruction, and then your reward depends on fulfilling that instruction correctly. And then kind of the hope is that if you reward the agent for fulfilling the instruction correctly, it'll get them to actually understand instructions. And that kind of works up to a degree, but it's a pretty active and open area of research. Well, I think in some ways, all of that transfer learning stuff we talked about is kind of dealing with that question. I think the trouble is that the research community hasn't come up with like one way of doing that just works. So I think, you know, a lot of the challenge has to do with just like figuring out, well, how do you represent that kind of knowledge, and how do you then utilize it to make acquisition of new behaviors or adaptation faster or better? And there's like, it's not that there's no way of doing it, it's that there's like a million different ways, and no one has sort of settled down on the right way to frame that problem. All right, let's move on. So there's the third perspective I wanted to get through, which is maybe a little different, but might, and appropriately, it's a little bit broader, but might get us thinking about RL in a different way. So why does deep learning work, just like regular supervised deep learning? At some really high level, it works because you can take a really big model with a big data center that costs lots of money, and you can take a big data set, maybe a labeled data set, and if you put those things together, then you get good generalization. And then a lot of what people are trying to do is, well, figure out how you can relax some of those requirements, like maybe you can get away with a big data set that is not entirely labeled, or you can take your big labeled data set and add more unlabeled data to it, and maybe get better results. You know, the basic supervised recipes work really well across a range of settings, but everyone wants better results, and getting lots and lots of labeled data is difficult. So if you have, you know, if all of machine learning is powered entirely by labeled data, then there's sort of a limit to how far it can scale. So reducing the supervision burden is something that a lot of people have been concerned with. And what people have thought about is, well, ways to use kind of cheap, easy to get data, like kind of garbage data that you can just kind of find lying around on the street, and that's free to get, and you can just use lots of it, and maybe that'll improve your system. So typically, this is like data gathered from the internet. So if you have a million labeled images, if you can somehow take that million labeled images and combine it with like 100 million unlabeled images and get a better result, well, that's really good because you've just used that cheap data that otherwise would have gone to waste. And arguably, people have been pretty successful with this. So large language models, for instance, work basically on this principle. They use cheap, readily available, unlabeled text data. You can use them to train up a language model. And then you can have a much more limited data set, for example, of English to French paired data to learn machine translation, right? So it's a recipe that has actually served us well as a community for a while. So this is what like self-supervised and unsupervised learning is supposed to do. But where does the knowledge in that cheap, low-quality data really come from? What is it that we're learning if we have an unsupervised or self-supervised learning system that uses, like a language model, for example? Well, classically, what it's learning is P of X. So if your data is X, like X is like a sentence or X is an image, it's learning the distribution of natural sentences or natural images. Which distribution? Well, it's the one that you got from the garbage heap, because that's what you're using. So this is what, for example, language models do. And that's a little bit of a problem because, well, in the end, what you're learning about is the knowledge possessed by whoever collected the data set. So if the data set that we're talking about is like photographs off of Flickr, what you're really learning about is the kind of tendencies that people have when they take photographs that they then put on Flickr. And if you're learning this from the garbage heap, well, you're kind of learning a bunch of garbage. And that's not, you know, all bad because there is some, you know, real signal contained in just arbitrary internet data. But it also shows up in the kinds of pathologies that we see. So certainly, control of large language models is a major challenge. Like, you know, you have to work pretty hard to figure out how to get them to spit out the answer that you want instead of spitting out something that looks like a random Reddit comment on some, you know, kind of toxic forum that spews out insults. So, you know, and as an aside, perhaps this is actually why prompting large language models is such an art and why there's all sorts of other issues with unsupervised techniques. So where I'm going with this is that, well, maybe RL can provide us with a different way of thinking that can perhaps in the future overcome some of these challenges. So stepping back a bit, we can ask a very basic question. Why do we need machine learning? And to answer that, we can step back even further and ask an even more basic question. Why do we need a brain? Because yeah, machine learning is kind of like an artificial brain, so it kind of makes sense. We start by asking, why do we need a brain? That's a brain. So there is a guy who can answer that question named Daniel Walpert. He's a very well-known neuroscientist. And Daniel Walpert has this to say. We have a brain for one reason and one reason only, and that's to produce adaptable and complex movements. Movement is the only way we have of affecting the world around us, and I believe that to understand movement is to understand the whole brain. Now, it won't surprise you to know that Professor Walpert works on the neuroscience of motor control, but he kind of has a point. Because all that stuff that the brain does in the end only matters insofar as the outputs affect the world, and they affect the world by, you know, moving your muscles. So maybe we can add a postulate that we need machine learning for one reason only, and that's to produce adaptable and complex decisions. Because that's the only way that your machine learning system at the end of the day is going to affect the world. It's not about whether it predicted the correct answer or not, it's about whether it made a decision that led to the outcome that you wanted. So from that perspective, everything is a decision. Like obviously how the robot moves its joints is a decision, how the car drives is a decision. But even for an image classifier, it outputs some label. That label implicitly is a decision. Maybe it's the image label that's the decision, but maybe it's actually the downstream consequence. So you're going to tag your friend in a photograph, or your machine learning algorithm is going to tag your friend in a photograph that you posted on Facebook. Well, that's a decision. It's going to affect how you interact with Facebook, and it's going to affect how your friend feels, how you feel, et cetera. So that's a decision with consequences. So whether it's tagging a user's photograph or detecting an endangered animal in a camera trap, these are all decisions that lead to outcomes. And there's presumably some outcome that you actually want. And the reason that you're using machine learning is because you would rather get the outcomes you want rather than the ones that you don't want. So these are all decisions, and they lead to consequences. So maybe this suggests a way that we could think about using lots of unlabeled or cheap data instead of using it to learn the data distribution. Maybe we can use it to learn some general strategy for attaining the outcomes that we want. Essentially use it as evidence of how the world works. So you could think of reinforcement learning as a way to use cheap previously collected data with a limited amount of supervision. The supervision is what defines the task. So the cheap unlabeled data tells you how the world works, and the rest of the limited supervision tells you what the task is. And you know, it's very easy to think about this in the parlance of model-based RL, because then it's literally, you can use the cheap data to learn a model. But even for model-free RL, you can use it as a way to perform those Bellman backups or something like that. So a way to make this a little more concrete, maybe you have, if you're controlling a robot, you might have a big data set from past interactions. Those maybe are things you've already done before, so it's kind of cheap, it's easy to get, you've already done it. But maybe it's not exactly what you want, but it can be used as a source of data when combined with a new task to train up some reasonable model. Okay? So that's kind of the idea behind this perspective, that if all machine learning at the end is about making decisions that lead to outcomes, perhaps a really good way to use cheap, readily available data is to learn how to achieve possible outcomes that you might want. Now, of course, this has a problem if you're using RL naively, because with naive RL, all of this is a costly interaction process if done in the real world, so you don't want to actually have your RL agent like playing in the garbage dump. So what you might want here is offline reinforcement learning. So if you can take cheap readily available data, and you have access to an offline reinforcement learning method that actually works, then that might be a good combination to utilize that data in an effective way, because it removes the need to interact with the world. So then the recipe might be something like get a large data set of diverse but possibly low quality behavior, maybe videos, something like that, or past interaction for a robot, or lots of data from dash cameras of cars driving around. Run some kind of offline reinforcement learning procedure, which could be learning some human defined objectives, or it might be even learning something fully self-supervised like goal conditioned RL, or self-supervised skill discovery like what we discussed in the unsupervised RL lecture, something that basically uses the data to learn how to achieve potential viable outcomes. And then that might provide a really good initialization for learning downstream tasks where whatever the downstream task is, even if it's not itself an RL task, it probably involves making some kind of decision, and therefore pre-training for decision making might give you a really good starting point for that. So that's basically the idea. And there is actually research that goes in that direction, research on unsupervised RL, research on offline reinforcement learning, and research on things like goal-conditioned RL. And some of that work has actually studied pre-training and fine-tuning as well. All right, so I'll pause here and ask you guys if you have any questions, comments, objections, and so on. Yeah? Yeah, and you could imagine doing it in a variety of ways. You could imagine doing offline pre-training and then online fine-tuning. Or you could imagine that maybe at the end you get a little bit of label data for your downstream task and you do offline fine tuning. And people have done both of those things, actually. Yeah? So for those that didn't hear, this is reminiscent of Kahneman's System 1 and System 2, where you can think of the pre-training as learning a kind of a System 1 and a downstream task as the System 2 part. Potentially. That's not quite what I was going for. I was kind of thinking that, well, both of these are kind of system one things. But I do think that you could approach it that way. You could think of, for example, learning some skills or instincts from the prior data and then doing some kind of planning for the new task. And that's not what I was thinking about, but I think that's a potentially a good idea. Any others? OK. Here's an example, actually, of goal-conditioned RL pre-training with fine-tuning. So this is actually a robotics experiment that was done at Google a couple of years back, or 1 year back, on learning a goal-conditioned policy for a robot. So here the robot gets an image of the goal it's supposed to accomplish. That's not actually all that valuable by itself, because you don't want to specify goals for a robot by giving it a photograph. But it's a unsupervised procedure in the sense that all the robot data that this team collected could be used to train this thing. This is using an offline RL method like CQL, which we learned about. And then it was actually used as an unsupervised pre-training objective. So then some downstream tasks could be specified with a regular reward function, and this goal condition thing would accelerate that. So that's the blue curve, which is accelerated with that goal condition pre-training. I'll skip the language models part, but yes, you can do this with language models. It's in the slides. We'll post them on the website. Since I'm almost out of time, I want to conclude and kind of bring things back to the bigger picture. So in the very beginning of this class, in the first lecture, we talked about this kind of notion that maybe learning can be the basis of intelligence, that perhaps reinforcement learning is what allows us to reason about decision making, and deep models are what allows RL algorithms to learn to represent complex input-output mappings, the sort of really complex mappings that we might need to handle the demands of an intelligent agent in the real world. So deep models are what allow reinforcement learning algorithms to solve complex problems end to end. And you know, maybe some of these perspectives that I discussed give you some potential thoughts on how that could happen. There are certainly lots of things missing. One slide that I like to show towards the end of this course is this slide that I borrowed from Yann LeCun, which I don't entirely agree with, but I think it provides some interesting perspectives on AI. So the point that Yann LeCun makes when he shows this slide is that, well, different kinds of machine learning techniques enjoy different amounts of supervision. So you can think of reinforcement learning as getting fairly sparse supervision in the sense of, well, you just get a reward signal and you have to somehow back out what you're supposed to do from that reward signal. So it's hard to learn maybe a lot about the world if that's all you get. Supervised learning maybe has a little bit more supervision because you're getting, let's say you're doing image classification, you're getting a label. Maybe there's you know, 1,000 labels, so there's 10 bits per sample of supervision. Whereas some sort of unsupervised learning or learning to predict what happens in the world has much more supervision, because if you're predicting like a whole image, there's many, many bits of supervision in that. So his theory is that, well, perhaps we really need unsupervised learning or predictive learning to get that kind of basis of understanding about the world on which we can build everything else. And that's kind of an interesting idea. But maybe what that slide really gets at is we should think about where the signal comes from. And there's a few different hypotheses you could formulate. So the Yann LeCun's cake kind of picture says that, well, maybe that signal really needs to come from unsupervised or predictive learning, like learn how the world works and then build everything on that. So generative modeling of the world. But perhaps, you know, there's other hypotheses you could formulate. Maybe it has something to do with social learning. Perhaps it's about imitation or understanding the world by leveraging signals from other agents. And that also contains a lot of supervision. So we're social animals and we have a culture, and maybe for a reason. And maybe RL agents could learn a lot that way too. Or there's also, I think, a perfectly viable theory that is kind of an RL purist theory, that maybe all that stuff about reinforcement learning having a small amount of supervision is kind of bunk. Actually, reinforcement learning has lots of supervision, because you're not just getting the reward function, you're also backing up that reward function through your dynamics, and you are actually indirectly learning about how the world works just through a very particular mechanism. So that's kind of the, you know, the giant value backup, that once you get that plus one reward at the end, everything kind of snaps into place because you have all the transitions that led there, and you can use that to learn some very powerful models. Essentially, it's like saying that implicit in learning a value function, you're actually learning a model of the world. That's also a reasonable theory. And there may be other theories. It may be some combination of the above. But it's kind of an interesting way to think about the AI problem is, well, whatever method you're developing, if you think that method will learn a lot about how the world works, you might want to have a theory about where it's getting that signal. OK. And then the last thing I want to end on is just you know, a little bit of very subjective unsolicited advice for you guys, that if you're interested in answering some of the questions that I posed in this lecture, not just the last slide, but the whole thing, some thoughts about things to do if you want to do that, Well, first is like pick the right problems. So to pick the right problems is not easy, but there are a few questions you can ask that could help. You can ask, does this have a chance of solving an important problem? If you're working on something, does it have a chance of solving something that actually matters? It might seem like a very basic thing, but sometimes if you actually ask that, you'll find that the answer is no. Optimism in the face of uncertainty is a really good exploration strategy. So it's really good to work on things that, in the best case, will turn out to be really awesome. It's even better to work on things that, even in the worst case, will turn out to be really awesome, but there's rarely things like that available in research. But at least work on something that, in the best case, will turn out to be really awesome. And we know that that's an optimal exploration strategy from back when we talked about UCB. Don't be afraid to change the problem statement. So often, a lot of the best research really comes from trying to mix up the assumptions or the objectives. And many of the challenges that I discussed won't be met by iterating on existing benchmarks or even iterating under the existing problem statements. Applications really matter. So it's important to sometimes consider applying methods to realistic and changing and challenging real-world domains, because they can teach you a lot about the important bits that are missing. NRL has a long history of disregarding this fact. So there's a lot of RL research that is, you know, maybe operating under assumptions that don't make it as relevant. So it's important to remember how this stuff could actually be used, even if it's long-term fundamental research. Think big and start small. So think about big problems that you want to solve in the long run, maybe over your lifetime, over your career, or over the existence of human civilization, perhaps. But then also think about small steps that you can take now that would actually be verifiable that can get you on that path. All right, thank you very much.